Blackstone Audio presents Courting Disaster: How the CIA Kept America Safe and How Barack Obama is Inviting the Next Attack by Marc A. Thiessen. For Harry, Sam, and all the brave men and women who stopped the next 9/11, not torturers, heroes. Author's note: you should not be reading this book. I should not have been able to write it. This volume contains some of the most sensitive intelligence information our country possesses, the secrets behind how the CIA successfully interrogated the men who killed thousands on September 11, 2001, and stopped them from killing thousands more. This information has been leaking, drip by drip, into the public domain for years, as irresponsible government officials have shared secrets they swore to protect with the news media, and left-wing journalists have twisted this information to paint our intelligence community as a band of rogue operators who abandoned our ideals in the fight against terror. When Barack Obama took office, those drips turned into a torrent, as the new president released reams of highly classified documents describing the details of our nation's interrogation policies. President Obama declared our intelligence professionals had committed torture. They did nothing of the sort. And while Obama's revelations have done enormous damage to our national security, they have also made it possible to prove that he is wrong. Now, for the first time, the true story can finally be told. The story of how dedicated men and women at the Central Intelligence Agency went head-to-head with the world's most dangerous terrorists, got them to tell us their plans, and kept America safe for 8 years. This is the story of how Barack Obama has exposed their secrets to the enemy, unilaterally disarmed us in the face of terror, and invited the next attack. Introduction. Sheikh Osama warned you. It is the morning of September 11th, 2006. President Bush wakes up at 5 a.m., and after breakfast with the First Lady, he walks down the colonnade past the Rose Garden to the Oval Office. There, he receives his morning briefing from the Director of National Intelligence and then calls in his speechwriters to make final edits on his televised address that night, marking the fifth anniversary of the 9/11 attacks. At 8:46 a.m., the moment the first plane struck the North Tower, the President walks out to the South Lawn with Mrs. Bush, Vice President Cheney, and Mrs. Cheney to observe a moment of silence. The networks cover the event live and then cut back to New York City, where the families of the fallen are gathered at Ground Zero for memorial ceremonies. As bagpipes play in the background, a morning show anchor interviews former Mayor Rudy Giuliani about his recollections of the day. Suddenly, the coverage is interrupted by a breaking news bulletin. Networks are receiving reports that air traffic controllers have lost contact with United Airlines Flight 931, bound for San Francisco from London's Heathrow Airport. The plane suddenly fell off the radar screen as it crossed the Atlantic Ocean. Reporters scramble to figure out what has happened when a second report comes in. Air traffic controllers have lost contact with another plane, United Flight 959, bound for Chicago, also departing from Heathrow. Moments later, another report. Air Canada Flight 849, bound for Toronto, has gone missing. Then another. Air Canada Flight 865, bound for Montreal, has disappeared. Then another. American Airlines Flight 131, bound for New York, has disappeared. Then another. United Flight 925, bound for Washington, has disappeared. Then another. American Airlines Flight 91, bound for Chicago, has disappeared. As the reports roll in, it becomes clear that the unimaginable has happened. Al-Qaeda terrorists have hijacked seven planes carrying at least 1,500 passengers and blown them up as they crossed the Atlantic. It is the second deadliest terrorist attack in history, surpassed only by the 9/11 attack itself. The following day, as images of debris floating in the ocean fill our TV screens, the terrorists' martyrdom videos are delivered to Al Jazeera and broadcast to the world. One of the hijackers sputters, We will rain upon you such terror and destruction that you will never know peace. There will be floods of martyrdom operations and bombs falling through your lands. The ringleader of the plot, a terrorist named Abdullah Ahmed Ali, pokes his finger at the camera and declares, "Sheikh Osama warned you. Now the time has come for you to be destroyed." 5 years after striking the Pentagon and World Trade Towers, al-Qaeda has launched another mass casualty attack to rival the destruction of September 11, 2001. A scenario like this did not happen, in part because the following scenario did. Just before dawn on March 1, 2003, 24 heavily armed Pakistani tactical assault forces move in and surround a safe house in Rawalpindi. A few hours earlier, they had received a text message from an informant inside the house. It read, "I am with KSM." Bursting in, they find the disheveled mastermind of the 9/11 attacks, Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, in his bedroom. KSM lunges for a rifle and shoots one of the Pakistani soldiers in the foot before being finally subdued. He is taken into custody along with another senior al-Qaeda operative, Mustafa al-Hassawi, the paymaster of the 9/11 plot. In the safe house, they find a treasure trove of computers, documents, cell phones, and other valuable pocket litter. Once in custody, KSM is defiant. He refuses to answer questions, informing his captors that he will tell them everything when he gets to America and sees his lawyer. But KSM is not taken to America to see a lawyer. Instead, he is taken via a third country to a secret CIA black site in an undisclosed location. Upon arrival, KSM finds himself in the complete control of Americans. His head and face are shaved. He is stripped naked. His physical condition is documented through photographs, and he undergoes a medical exam and psychological interview. He does not know where he is, how long he will be there, or what his fate will be. Despite his circumstances, KSM still refuses to talk. He spews contempt at his interrogators, telling them that Americans are weak, lack resilience, and are unable to do what is necessary to prevent the terrorists from succeeding in their goals. He has trained to resist interrogation. When he is asked for information about future attacks, he tells his questioner scornfully, "Soon you will know." It becomes clear he will not reveal the information using traditional interrogation techniques. So, he undergoes a series of enhanced interrogation techniques approved for use only on the most high-value detainees.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.